Hello, my name is Daniel Pizac. I am working in the CATIA organization, and it's a pleasure for me to start a series of talks. Those talks are about CATIA. And you know, in CATIA, you have a lot of capabilities. It's very, very, very rich. But some of them are just jewels, and they are kept secret. It's the best kept secret jewels of CATIA. They are not well known. And my idea is to start a series of talks about all those best kept secret jewels of CATIA. And the first one today is called Virtual to Real Shape Morphing. Again, it's a pleasure to introduce you. I will just spend a couple of minutes, 5-6 minutes, and then we will have some minutes for questions and answer, hopefully. And let's share my screen, and I will do a live demo of CATIA. So here we are talking about CATIA 3D experience. And as you can see, I have just a car door, okay? Not big issue. Now let's just move it away. You see, it's a car door, it's made of surfaces. And what is the goal of virtual to real shape morphing? It's very simple. You have a CAD nominal data. This is a car door. It's just a surface model. And you stamp this sheet metal part. And during the stamping process, as you know, a lot of deformation occur. One of them is called the spring back. And in this particular case, we compute with an FES software. In this case, it was not Dassault System software. It was another software, third-party software. And I will show you how we can use this result of the prediction of the spring back to compensate. So I will deform the actual nominal CAD data to have a wrong part that once stamped will deliver the proper sheet metal part. So virtual to real shape morphing, this is in 3D experience CATIA. It's called Realistic Shape Optimizer in CATIA V5, and the capabilities are very, very similar. So let's start. I go to my digitized morphing feature. I select my set of surfaces. It can be unstitched surfaces. It can be a join, like here. It can be a solid. It can be an assembly. It works on any type of geometry. And now I will just select, for example, an accuracy. I will select some parameters to ignore some of the points which are maybe out of range versus the deformation. And I select, of course, the result of this FES software, which predicted the distortion of the sheet metal part during the stamping. So let's search for my data. Here it is. It is in the 3D experience platform already. It can be an ASCII file. Let me show you this ASCII file very quickly. Here you see just x, y, z, dx, dy, dz, which are the coordinates of the displacements of the node, because this prediction of distortion has been done on a mesh. The mesh was, of course, computed on a set of surfaces. And you can see here x, y, z, dx, dy, dz. I will switch back to CATIA. And here you just make a preview. First of all, you can display the displacement. You see, the displacement are just the origin, the target, and in fact, in green, you see a line, which is the vectors, okay? Let's do a preview. And you see here the part, which the set of surfaces which have been modified according to this result of prediction of distortion. Of course, on this thin shape, the deformation is much bigger than on the other surfaces. You can see I had 30,000 points in my finite element analysis. And here, if I say scale one, I will just match or morph the CAD model to match the result of the prediction of the distortion. But it's not what I want. I want to compensate for this distortion. So I just change the scale here. Here we go. Preview. And here you see the deformation has been put or brought to the CAD model on the opposite direction. Let's say I'm fine with that. And now I approximate the surface to match the distortion. And you can see here, the good news is that we do not change the topology of the part. So let's change the color. Property. Here we go. Graphic. I will put this guy in red. You see here, it's really the same topology. If those surfaces are G1 or G2 or G0 continuous, they will keep this type of continuity. So same topology, same quality of the model, but it has been morphed to compensate for the distortion. Let's show now a more sophisticated example. Still my surface here. But in fact, what happened is that, okay, we had this prediction of distortion. We apply the compensation. We maybe mill the stamping dies. We maybe try out the stamping tool. And this is the first sheet metal part coming from the shop floor. We are scanning the shop, the part which has been stamped. But in fact, you will see that in this particular case, this is a scan data. There are still an issue. So the prediction was okay, but there is still an issue, okay? Yeah, there is a difference. So what can we do for that? It's very simple, in fact. Oops. You see here the difference. In fact, you can use in virtual to real shape morphing, you can use laws. Okay, which means, in fact, you will compute as many deformation laws as you have in your process. For example, prediction distortion, first law. The scanning data, second law. Maybe you will apply on this particular part because the stamping die is very heavy. So the weight of the stamping part might also create a deformation of the die, so elasticity law. And maybe you would like, because it's a second operation, or the third operation, you would like to take into account the thinning, because this is a sheet metal part, but once stamped, the thickness is not constant. And you can predict also the thinning of the part. So you can accumulate 1, 2, 3, 4, as many laws, and then apply this set of law only once on the CAD data. This is what I will show you here. So now I just compute a deviation analysis. So maximum value is 4.40 millimeter positive, negative, it's 5.65 in this particular case. So I just compute the deviation between the scan data and the actual CAD model. And I just use this law, this deformation to, and this deviation analysis as an input instead of using the result of the finite element analysis. I use this deviation analysis. So here now, let's have a look at the law. So my first feature is just the -1 scaling from, as you can see, the document representing the ASCII file XYZ DX DY DZ coming from the third party software predicting the distortion. Okay. Now I have also my second law, which is based on the deviation analysis, so the scan data. And good news, I can combine them. And the third law, it's just a combination of the two of them. And then you see here the result. This is my very first deformation, or counter deformation to be more precise. This is the small counter deformation on the scan data. And I just accumulate those two deformations to get the final one, which is here. And we just change the color of this guy, maybe put in green. And in fact, the one I will use is this one, and it's very clean data, again, very accurate. So you can see how very, very easily you can not only deform or counter deform a set of unstitched surfaces, a joint surface, a solid, a set of solids, but I can also accumulate multiple laws and apply at the very, very end the accumulation of those laws. Let's finish now to show you exactly the same stuff, but not on a NASCII file coming from, which is a displacement file coming from a third-party software, neither a scan data, but a solid where we computed the deformation with our Simulia apps. I will just share a third application. So what you see on the screen is an additive manufacturing part. It's in titanium. And our Simulas software, additive manufacturing researcher, perform thermal analysis and a thermomechanical analysis, because during the printing, you know, there are a lot of constraints, a lot of the gradient of temperature are huge. So the part is really deformed. It's like welding almost. And our Simulas app could, and in fact, compute the distortion, predict the distortion, because all the parameters, the laser speeds, of course, the nature of the material, the power of the laser, the number of layers, the strategy of the laser, the recoater time, and so on and so on. And all those parameters have been taken into account to perform this distortion prediction. So very easily, I compute the distortion. And now I switch from Simulia to CTIA, virtual to real shape morphing. Here we go. This is a solid. It's not a set of surfaces. It's not a join. It's a solid. I use the same digitized morphing capability. Select the solid. Now select a simulation case. So here in my window, I just select the simulation case object. Here we go. Now you can see here on the right side, you can see the number of points and so on and so on. I can show them. And in a similar way that I used for the car door, I will deform the solid first, for example, to match the distortion, just to show you what is the result, because I put a scale 1. But obviously, the idea is to print a good part. So I will deform the actual CAD data and change the scale from 1 to minus 1, update my feature. And now I have exactly what will be printed. And hopefully, the result will be good on the 3D printer. Here we go. So it was short. I hope you enjoy it. At least I enjoy to be with you. In a couple of days, I will show you another very good jewel of CUTIA. It's called Generative Shape Optimizer. And I'm sure you will be surprised. So stay tuned. Now, if you have any question, feel free. It's not ISMSurf. I have a question regarding, is it ISMSurf? No, it's CUTIA. It's CUTIA virtual to real shape morphing. It's part of many, many roles in 3D experience CUTIA. In V5, it's called Realistic Shape Optimizer. For sure, if you want to do the deviation analysis, you need to have our digitized shape preparation, which is an app inside a role in 3D experience, but it's also in CUTIA V5 called Digitized Shape Editor. We have a lot of customers using that, to be honest, a lot of them. It's a jewel. It's not known enough. It's why I show you that. But a lot of references, a lot of customers are using it worldwide. Okay, and it also applies on Class A surfaces. You know, if you have an outer body like the car door I was showing you, it also works. It ensures high quality, and it keeps the design intent of the Class A surfaces. So there are some incentives. You have to use some tools to prepare the data. It's not as quickly as here what was shown. For sure, it's much easier on an underbody or non-seen part in a car body. But it also works on Class A surfaces. It is supporting exact JT data, yes, because you can import, especially in 3D experience, JT data directly on the platform. Here I used the CUTIA 3D experience CUTIA on the cloud to make this demo. So you can just drag and drop your JT data, for example, in a 3D drive, which is our Dropbox type of data tool. And then from the 3D drive, you can import it in CUTIA. It's 3D experience CUTIA. Of course, you can use it for plastic trim parts. I have a lot of customers in the transportation mobility doing bumpers, doing even air conditioning, complex solid parts were using it. So 3D printing, stamping, casting, Also, even machining sometimes, if you have very, very, very long and thin parts, if you mill them, there will be a bend. And if you want to compensate for the bending during the machining, you can also use this type of solution. The replay will be available, yes, of course, in the CATIA community. And if you want some other examples, just contact me through the community and I will be very, very happy to answer. Any other question? If not, how meshing done for simulation? It's a good question. The simulation in this particular case for the 3D printing, the mesh has been done by the Simulia apps. You can either do a voxel mesh if you want to go very, very quickly, or shell mesh or tetrahedral mesh, or you can combine those meshing together. Typically, especially in 3D printing, the build tray will have a special mesh quality. The support will have another mesh quality and maybe another type of mesh. And the part itself will be probably mesh with a different type of elements. But this is perfectly done by the additive manufacturing researcher role, which contains this Simulia app. In the beginning, you did some A to B conversion for door panel. I'm not sure I understand how we can analyze it in simulation. The A to B conversion was a morphing of a part to match the result of a prediction of a distortion computed by a dedicated software that there are some on the market who are doing that. But it's the result of a simulation. We took the part, we predict the spring back. The result was a displacement file, a lot of small vectors. And I use these small vectors described in an ASCII file to compensate for the distortion. Or, like I did for the scan, I use the scan data, I perform a deviation analysis between the part and the scan data. And this deviation analysis, which is also a set of vector, can be used. It's completely parametric, so it's a feature. If now you change either the part, the file coming from another software, or of course, in my case, in Simulia for the printing, you change some parameters in the simulation of the printing and you see that the displacement are different, it's fully parametric. That's the beauty. By the way, the various laws, I only combine two laws, but you may have 10 laws and maybe one of them is changed. You just need to modify one of them and everything is fully automatic. We don't change mesh, we don't touch mesh, okay? It's not an FEA tool, it's a morphing tool. We take various input, but we don't change mesh. It's not a mesh morphing tool, which is useless because mesh morphing tool is providing a mesh. And what is better than a mesh? It's an exact surface or solid BREP representation. So there are a lot of questions. I'm happy with that. topology. I'm not sure I understand can OI topology, but there is no topology change. Okay, I think you noticed that. And by the way, for example, in one particular area, there was a big bump, a big hole or a big bump. We keep the number of patches, we keep the number of a span, we don't change the topology. So the bump will be applied to the geometry, but we keep the topology. It can be used, and we have various customers using it, not for spring back, not for tooling, not for molding, not for printing, not for casting, but just, let's imagine you have a big product. Let's say a plane. The plane is very heavy. Every component of a plane is very heavy. Some people would like to know how the plane will look like just because of the weight of the plane. Okay, so you can make just a structural analysis that will find out for you how all components of your product will just bend, and you can apply this result of simulation to the complete assembly. And you will have the exact representation of the, for example, of the plane because of its weight, or a car because of its weight, or even more simple parts. I think that's it. If you have more questions, please use the community. I will be, again, very, very happy to answer. Don't miss the next one, Generative Shape Optimizer. You will be surprised. And again, it was a pleasure to be with you. have a nice end of day or beginning of day, and bye-bye.